Dear students, welcome to this philosophy class, The Microscope and the Elephant. Let's start with the microscope here and the elephant. Why is this course called The Microscope and the Elephant? Well, the idea is that this class is about zooming out. Well, the rest of your courses, the rest of the philosophy course, of your science course, is about zooming in. And in zooming in, you use a microscope. In this class, imagine that you have a microscope and you get samples from an assistant from another room from an elephant. So, and at some point, so you look through the microscope and you make notes about all the samples. At some point, your assistant says, you have seen everything from the samples. So you have a big pile of notes, but if you have never seen the elephant or a picture of an elephant, would it be enough to just study through a microscope? Well, this is a rhetorical question. The answer is no. So that doesn't mean that it doesn't make sense to look through a microscope, but you should also look at the big picture. And this course is looking at the big picture about zooming out. So I'll start here. I use a lot of quotes by philosophers in this class. So this is the contemporary philosopher Martha Nussbaum. Okay. Knowledge is no guarantee of good behavior, but ignorance is a virtual guarantee of bad behavior. So this is an ethics class, and actually we hope to find arguments for good behavior. So that is what we will be heading for on this journey. So welcome. As you can see, this is a picture of students from a few years ago. Then there were still less students. Today it's much fuller. And here we have another quote, science alone cannot help us with the answers we need. If you have only science, you won't know what is good. For example, climate change, you can know that there is climate change, but is climate change something bad? Well, in order to answer that question, science cannot give you that answer. You need ethics for that. And that's why you are here today in this course, in this ethics class. Let me introduce you to our team. This you are with a lot of students, so we have a whole team of assistants to work with me, and also with a lot of with the grading, especially Natalie Hadoiza Castro. She will be assisting, and she's a PhD in on food ethics, and she will be the main contact person. And here we have Thomas Repp. You will see him also during the lectures. So here I introduce myself. So I'm assistant professor in environmental ethics here at the Copernicus Institute of Sustainable Development. So I teach, I'm a philosopher, but I'm also a public speaker, a writer, and I'm an environmentalist. With being an environmentalist, I mean that I not only have an academic interest in sustainable development, but I only really try. I also am an activist to really strive for a better environment. And if there would be one slogan which sums up everything which I do, it is this slogan: first of all, strive for less suffering, and then for more happiness. Well, at the end of the course, you will know much more about that. So as I said, I'm a writer, so actually in my work I focus mainly on books and popular writing, so not so much on academic papers. So there's one book in English, it's called Philosophy for a Better World. There was also a Dutch version of it. And then I've written a trilogy. I wrote a trilogy. My mother-in-law said trilogies are the best, so I wrote a trilogy. One is called The Happy Vegan, The Happy Feminist, and The Happy Atheist. So my newest book is Green Liberalism, and hopefully in next year there will also be an English translation of that book. So the content of this lecture, so this lecture is mainly about introducing you to this course and what the assignments are, a little bit of content. So I'll start with a warning, and it really is a warning. Then we do a classroom ethics about how we behave in class. I go through the mandatory reading, the study goals, the assignments, and then from here it is content about what is a canon, what is Bildung, and what is philosophy. So we'll start with a warning, risks ahead. And with a warning, I mean that the topics we address in this course can be quite difficult, but also difficult for your personal, for your identity. This class challenges you to also think about yourself. I use this philosopher, probably you have heard of him, it's a quite famous philosophy book. Here we have Harry Potter. And in the Harry Potter series, the second part of the book is called The Chamber of Secrets. So this is from the movie Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets. And the thing with a Chamber of Secrets is that if there is a door, let's say there is a door here, and if you open the door and you look into in that room, then you know the secret. And the thing is, you cannot unknow the secret. If you know a secret, if you know there is a pink dragon in there, you cannot pretend that you don't know. So I'll start with this warning that if you take this course and you happen to know, we are opening the Chamber of Secrets in this course, and you cannot unknow it. So if you think, I don't want to have any, to know secrets which might be inconvenient for my own life, then maybe this is not a good place to be. So this is, because you're all adults, this is your free choice to be here, and don't complain later that you haven't been warned. And the warning is also, to the content of the warning is that one of the things is that this, as you can see here, the elephant in the room, that usually we don't address the elephant in the room. And the elephant in the room is the ecological crisis, and we will deal with it quite a lot. So here, the ecological crisis here, but climate change, it's a lot about also, climate change is, ladies and gentlemen, it's only one small aspect of a huge environmental ecological crisis. And there's still people denying or being skeptical about climate change. Yeah, but that's what I like about this cartoon. The laws of gravity don't care, the laws of nature don't care whether or not you believe in them or not. So this is about the facts also, and they might be very inconvenient. And they are pretty inconvenient because we are on the verge of heading for the iceberg and not doing anything significantly about it, or even speeding up towards the iceberg. So that is really, really, really inconvenient. But you students, you are all students of global sustainability science, so you are really, well, maybe you can avert the ship so that we don't hit the iceberg. Let's see that. Yeah? Maybe you can stop the car before it's too late, before we are heading the abyss. And the other topic which we address is our relation with non-human animals. So you can see here, we will severely question how humans behave towards other non-human, towards other sentient beings. Quite inconvenient, all of this. Therefore, the warning. So now, this is an ethics class, but I would like to also to reflect on classroom ethics. Usually we don't address this literally, but here we do, because we address everything. So the classroom ethics, and the first important rule in this class is be on time. Because being late is for two reasons, is intolerable. One, it really disrupts the other students. It disrupts me as a lecturer. And the second, or third, it's also disrespectful for the class. It's like in theater. In theater, you also don't come too late. If you're too late, you just missed. And I'd like also to make the comparison with the train. You either get a train or not. You can have such, maybe you have good reason that you were late, but you didn't catch the train. fine, you take the next train. And well, the same here. If you're late, when you're late, you're welcome during the break when the next train comes by. And so and please take notice of this, because we're really going to do this. Second rule, classroom rule, is do not litter. When I leave the lecture hall, then I always check if it's clean. And there's a tendency for students to leave plastic cups, all kind of litter in the room. And I think that we shouldn't do that. And even if you, maybe the previous students did it, but then it's very easy for you to take it with you and to have a clean room and not make the cleaners do that. Because also the essence of environmental ethics is that we should not pollute. It's about not polluting so that others have to clean up. Polluting means that future generations have to clean up. So if you are interested in ethics and environmental ethics and in sustainable development, the beginning is that you do not litter. So don't take away your own litter. And of course, you take your own cup as your old GSS students. There's ethics and there's etiquette. Etiquette are social rules in how to behave politely. And maybe this is interesting. The most famous book on etiquette is by Baldassare Castiglioni, an Italian courtier. It's called The Book of Courtiers, about rules how to behave civically. Well, this is quite outdated. I'm not expecting you to behave like a courtier. But we still can be polite towards each other, towards the world, these are the three magical words you might know: sorry, please, and thank you. Yeah. So it's nice to be polite, and we can also practice that and stimulate that. And politeness is one, but being kind is, well, kind is maybe the next level of being polite, being kind to each other. We are here as students, maybe you don't all know each other, but we also have to, in this course, to work together. You will make a video assignment together, and you will be each other's peer reviewer. So try to help each other. Just be kind to each other, make each other compliment, help. And these are the small things which can help to make this world a better place. And that actually is the goal of this course. So these are not trivial points, these things about ethics and classroom ethics. These actually, it's are the trivial things which are important in life. Yeah, so I already said, one of the nice things you can easily do is, start to make a compliment, right? You are the best. Okay. Now, I will going to address the mandatory reading. In philosophy, we don't do so much experiments. One of the core actions in philosophy is dialogue and reading. Reading actually is also a kind of dialogue. In when you read a book, you are having a dialogue with the author. The author has a conversation, and you listen to it, and you have to respond to it. So, in this class, we do a lot of topics, and we read a lot of books, actually five. And there's this, and I will go through them here. There is this book, it's called The Microscope and the Elephant. It's not on here. This is a book which we, assistant and me, we compiled together, which has essays of all the students, example essays. You can either buy this book by me, and it's also fully available as PDF on Blackboard. And I really recommend that you read that book, because it also has a lot of instructions, the same kind of instructions as I give in this lecture. So that's really helpful, but it's not mandatory for the exam. The rest is mandatory for the exam. The first book is by Okasha. It's called Philosophy of Science. Actually, most of these books are, they look the same. Actually, they are the same. They are from this Oxford series called Oxford Very Short Introduction. And this is a wonderful series, which is which uses the same kind of layout and the same kind of model for a very short introduction to a wide range of topics. So actually, my hope is you're going to read like 1, 2, 3, 4. This one is also it. 5 of these books. My hope is that you maybe look for more of these books and find something that you think interesting, and then also continue reading it. So, the philosophy of science book. There's another book of which we only read one chapter. This book by Pigliucci. It's this book, Nonsense on Stilts, and we read one book, the one chapter. That's the chapter on pseudoscience. That chapter is on Blackboard, so you don't have to buy that book. But of course, this is a great book, so you recommend it to read it. But so we only read chapter 3. Then there's a book on ethics, political philosophy and animal ethics, and they're all from the Oxford Very Short Introduction series. And this one I just changed this year. This is quite new. It's just came out in 2019, Environmental Ethics, A Very Short Introduction. So that's it. A lot of reading, but it's also enjoyable to read. And here something went wrong, but that's okay. You still can see it. Assisting this course are three posters, and you can see that one here, philosophy of science, an ethics poster, and over this is the political philosophy poster. So these three posters actually give the whole structure of the lectures. So if you want to know what's important in the lecture, what is really the key points, then you can use these knowledge poster to find out what the structure is and how they relate to each other. Actually, but everything what's on the poster is also required to know. So you should, and it's also really helpful if you really know this all this by heart. So if you really know what's on the posters. Okay. Then there is recommended reading. So of course, and I will recommend a lot of books because I think that's important and it's also joyful and you can broaden your horizon by it. So recommended reading is, first of all, this book, the Oxford Dictionary of Philosophy. But for many of you, this course will be the first and maybe the only introduction to philosophy. And it's very helpful to look up terminology and also names into in the dictionary. And this dictionary is very accessible. It's not too academic. The lemmas are not too long, so you can really increase the amount of learning by also using a dictionary. Of course, you can start with using Wikipedia, but this is much more thought through. Of course, I already mentioned the book Notice on Stills, where How to Tell Science from Bunk, from which we read only one chapter. I can really recommend all the other chapters. Then there is my own book, Philosophy for a Better World. Here I have it, Philosophy for a Better World. If I will tell some things about my own philosophy, but if you want to read more about it in extensive, then you can read my own book or any of my other books in Dutch, of course. And then there are two internet encyclopedias on philosophy, both of which are peer-reviewed. So there's the Stanford Encyclopedia of Philosophy and the Internet Encyclopedia of Philosophy. And the good thing about these is, as I already said, they are peer-reviewed and you can quote from them. As I told you, you can look, it's not forbidden to look on Wikipedia, and it's also helpful to look on Wikipedia, but you should not quote from Wikipedia. If you have to write something, a column or an assignment, and you want to quote, then you can quote for any of these encyclopedias and not quote from Wikipedia. So now the study calls. Actually, what is it? What are the goals of this course? Well, therefore, I have looked at 6 study goals. So this is a philosophy course, so it starts with thinking. Here we have the famous The Thinker by Auguste Rodin, a famous sculptor. By the way, there are many it is in bronze, so there are many copies of it. If the closest copy of it is in the Singer Museum in Laren, and that's an. It used to be outside in the garden, and 2 years or 3 years ago, it was stolen from the garden. This bronze sculpture, and the police found it because the thieves wanted to sell the bronze, so not the statue, but the material, and it was already cut into pieces. In this where they found it, but it was all pieces were still there, and then they they put it together and they restored it, and now it's still in the Singer Museum, but it's not in the garden, but inside. So if you want to look at it, it's inside in the Singer Museum. First study goal is critical thinking. One of the things about critical thinking is that almost everyone thinks him or herself to be a critical thinking. But we have a great tendency to overestimate our own capacities for critical thinking. You can compare that to thinking about running. Like if you want to run a marathon, most people will think, okay, well, if I would want to run a marathon, I have to really train for that. And we understand that you cannot run a marathon without intensive training for that. But actually you can, critical thinking also requires a lot of training for it and really a lot of effort to become a good critical thinker. So that's the starting point to think that you might not be such a critical thinker as you think you are. And here we have this, it's called a Venn diagram with these circles. There are things that are true, and that's the truth. And there are beliefs. And many people have beliefs, but they might not be true. Now, of course, we want to have knowledge, and knowledge are beliefs which are also true. So critical thinking is to know that this is in your head, here, beliefs, and that not even your own beliefs are not necessarily true. So that's the beginning of critical thinking, is think, oh gee, maybe also I have beliefs which are not true, and how do I know if all my beliefs are true? Well, that requires a lot of effort, but most people think that everything they believe is also true. Well, if you believe that everything you believe is true, you're not a critical thinker, I can tell you that. So that's the first study goal, critical thinking. The second goal of this course is to have a basic introduction into some basics of philosophy. And this is not a course on the history of philosophy, but it gives you some tools to apply philosophy yourself. So this is more DIY, do-it-yourself philosophy. And it might be helpful for you. So some basic knowledge. And here it's also important to think, what do you want from this course? If you want to use this course also to have a broader interest, to broader your knowledge of philosophy, you can use a dictionary to go further and deeper. So that's also up to you, what do you want with it, which goal you want to extend. If you want to have a historical overview of philosophy, I can recommend this one. It's two books, but they're quite accessible, by Anthony Gottlieb, The Dream of Reason and The Dream of Enlightenment, which give a nice overview of the history of philosophy. And this one, I recommend this one as well. Here I have it, here. By philosopher Anthony Graylin, Ideas That Matter, A Personal Guide for the 21st Century. This is what a contemporary philosopher has to say about a lot of issues about ethics, philosophy. So it is more on content and not historical. But so it's up to you, what do you want? Do you want to know more about the topic or more the history or both? That's up to you, or none. So, third study goal is basic tools, some basic tools which you can apply in your daily life. So this is actually more focusing on the critical thinking, that you have basic philosophical tools, and these tools, they're really concrete tools, are from two topics, two domains of philosophy. They come from philosophy of science and ethics. This whole course consists of two modules. First, we started philosophy of science, and then a bigger module continues with ethics. Critical thinking and debate. So these tools are here in this book. This is a small book, Critical Thinking, the Basics. So, because actually, I recommend that you go further with it, because I only touch upon really the basics of the basics. We're not even dealing completely with the basics. So I just show you what you could do and how you can develop yourself further without giving you it really in detail. So this is maybe the difference between academic learning and learning in, well, for example, in high school. In high school, they present you all the knowledge, and I just give you pieces and show you where you can develop yourself further. So this is really a difference. The fourth study goal here is self-reflection, or reflection on the interaction between science and society. How does science relate to society? And this is a beautiful drawing by the Dutch artist Escher. It's a self-portrait, so you can see in a glass ball he's looking at himself and also drawing. So the thing about this course is that it's also about yourself and the relation between what you do as science and society. So it's not, it has to do with the connection. And the fifth study goal is really practical. We're going to practice writing. And we're going to practice writing for a general public. Because in the rest of the courses, there is a lot of attention to writing academic papers. But here, we're going to focus on writing for a general audience. So for quality newspapers or opinion magazines or blogs. So that's what we learn here. The last study goal, sixth study goal, is creative learning. And here we have, it's called Bloom's taxonomy. That's a concept from pedagogy, from didactics, about how people learn. And there are different domains or skills of learning, from just remembering how things are, to understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating. And the highest level is to be creative with the material. And in our course, remembering basically is, there are two exams. Understanding by writing and analyze and applying also by writing. So, but there was not so much creativity in the course. And by adding a new assignment, we've done this a few times now, that's having students make a video on a topic by themselves using the material. So that is indeed in order to stimulate creativity. So here we have all the study goals, critical thinking skills, basic knowledge of philosophy, basic philosophical tools, reflection on the interaction between science and society, academic popular writing, and creative learning. To wrap everything up from this part, actually, what I'd like you to do is to think for yourself. That's actually the key value or skill that I would like to stimulate in you. So, and here there's a quote by Christopher Hitchens: "Take the risk of thinking for yourself. Much more happiness, truth, beauty, and wisdom will come to you that way."